Good morning, Lisa.
Morning.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the general lecture for Summer Course 2023 presented by Department of Marine Science and Technology, Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Science, IPB University. We would like to express our heartfelt gratitude to the head of the Department Marine Science and Technology, Dr. Samsul Bahri Agus, SPE, MSE, the Honorable Summer Course Coordinator, Dr. Beginner Subhan, the honorable speakers, Dr. Lisa Becking and Dr. Alan Koropitan, honorable lecturers and staffs of the Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Science, IPB University, and last, the honorable ladies and gentlemen, participants of the lectures. First of all, I give praise and gratitude to God who has been giving us blessings so that we can gather in this lecture without any obstacle. Today is a great honor for me, Niken Octaviandini, to be able to join and welcome each and every one of you in the closing of Marine Tropical Ecology Summer Course 2023. Earlier this month, we already conduct a field trip for this summer course that was attended by participants from various countries. We will also have another summer course next year, so please stay tuned and check our social media to keep informed about this program. Before we get into the main event, there will be forewords and introductions which will be delivered by the coordinator of the Marine Tropical Ecology Summer Course 2023. I cordially invite Dr. Beginner Subhan to give a speech.
Okay, good afternoon. Our distinguished lecturer, Dr. Lisa Becking and Dr. Alan, we are very happy to have you here, and our honorable head of department, Dr. Samsul and all the participants of the general lecture. Good afternoon. Yeah, finally, yeah, we all have in the last session, yeah, of the summer course. Yeah, we are very happy. The summer course already run, yeah, with several students from different countries, and then we can share or exchange our knowledge during the field trips, and we have a new insight about the marine tropical ecology. And as the organizer, we send our apologize if the summer course is there's a lot of some things we need to improve, and we hope next year we will meet again with the new summer course. That's all from me. Thank you very much. Good afternoon.
Thank you for the four words, Dr. Beginner Subhan. Next, there will be an opening speech from the head of Department Marine Science and Technology that also marks the official closing of the summer course 2023 for Dr. Shamsul. Okay, so the time is yours.
Okay, thank you, Niken. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for the opportunity. First, I'd like to say thank you, Dr. Begin, as coordinator of summer course department PTK IPB, and our honorable speaker, Ibu Dr. Isa Beking. Hello, how are you from Naturalis Denderland, and Dr. Alan Kropitam from ITK IPB, and of course, thank you to all of the participants of ITK summer course who enrolled this course from the beginning until now. we start with a general lecture as an opening of the summer course, and we want to close today also with the general lecture that I hope will give you insight and knowledge from our incredible expertise as our speaker today. This program is a form of collaboration between IPB and several countries. We have participants from France, Myanmar, Malaysia, Japan, and Indonesia. Except from that, we also have great speaker from Netherlands, Japan, and Indonesia. And I think it's a good chance for you to make networking across the global. You already learned about marine tropical ecology of our online course, which is still ongoing until now. As you know, we face many threats to our ocean. Even though we come from different country with different culture and different climates, I believe the awareness of our marine environment keeps growing inside as we know more about the marine ecosystem. And it's very important for us to keep our coastal area and the ocean health, such as is SDGs, for which is like low water. Hopefully, this is not the end of our collaboration. Still, this is shall be a beginning of something bigger. And at the end, enjoy the general lecture. Thank you for Ibu Lisa and Bang Alan Kropitan, and have a nice day. Thank you, Niken. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you for the speech. Please give your reactions to Professor Dr. Syamsul.
Professor. Thank you.
Okay, so before we move to our main event, I would like to kindly ask all the students and participants to turn on your camera. We would like to take some pictures for documentations. Please take your positions looking into your cameras. Prepare your best pose, and I'll guide the photo session counting down from 3, 2, 1. Okay, I'll get the photo sessions. 3, 2, 1. Okay, so for the next agenda is our main event today. The lectures we have been waiting for. We are fortunate to have two outstanding speakers today. There will be two sessions. While the first lecture will be delivered by Dr. Lisa Beking from Wageningen University and Research. Dr. Lisa, can you hear me?
Yes, thank you.
All right, so without wasting much time, let's go straight for our first sessions. Dr. Lisa, the time and place is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And good morning, or more good afternoon to everyone. Matsore. I will share my screen. Let's see. I'm going to do it this way. And do you see the PowerPoint? Yes?
Okay. Yes, wonderful. Already.
Wonderful. Thank you. Yeah, so my name's Lisa Beking. I'm an associate professor at Wageningen University Research, and I am also a senior researcher at Naturalis Biodiversity Center. Both are in the Netherlands, but I work together a lot with IPB, as well as with various other Indonesian counterparts, at BRIN and University of Papua, and recently also with University of Patimura. So here, I'm just getting myself organized, pardon me. So I would like to talk today a little bit about the work we're doing on tropical marine biodiversity. And what I first would like to start out with, and I'm gonna see whether I can see the chat, hold on. I would like to ask people to just put in the chat, when I say biodiversity, what is it that you think of? What are the things that you think of when I say biodiversity? What is biodiversity? Anyone, anything goes, just write something. Sponges, sounds nice. So species. Anything else? There are no wrong answers, don't worry. DNA, right? So it's the genetic diversity. And anything else? Indonesia, okay. Right, great. Okay, so you basically have the good gist of it all. So with biodiversity, what we're talking about is the diversity of genes. So someone already mentioned DNA. So it's the diversity of genes, genes within species and species within ecosystems. So it's important to remember that when we talk about marine biodiversity, it's quite a large concept, and it has multi facets, and so it's important also to sort of identify, if you're working on it, like what aspect are you working on, because, and also if you want to protect it, there each level has a different sensitivity. All right, I'm going to do another thing of audience participation, but this one will be easier for you, I hope, because I have the question: when I say animal, what animal comes to mind? And what I want you to do is go to, with your phone, go to menti.com and then use this code. So if I say animal, what's the first thing that comes to mind? And here I'll put the, and it's anonymous, so don't worry, everyone can join. So everyone just grab your phone, go to menti.com. Do you see the Menti here? So go to menti.com and put in this code. So menti.com and then 5604-9937. Is it working? And then just fill in, if I say animal, what's the first animal you think of? Here, I'm gonna do it as well to see if it makes sure and it works. I haven't seen any responses. Is it not working? Normally this goes pretty quickly. There we go. We have six. We can do more. Come on. So if you think of an animal, what do you think? Oh, a clown, moving, shark, legs and hands. But okay, cool. So what animal do you think of? What's the first animal you think of when I say animal? You can fill in different things. Go ahead. I'm going to give you a little bit longer. Okay, so we have shark, a number of people have done shark, a number of people have done whales, cat, dugong, dolphin, legs and hands. Oh, more is coming in. Very good. 15. We can do more. Chicken, dinosaur. Sounds good. Let's see if I can move this down a bit. There we go. Dugong, clown. Okay, so please keep filling this in, but as you do, I just want you to think to yourself, do you see a certain pattern? Do you see a certain bias? So what I see is that most of these species are have eyes, like us, except for the coral. The coral is cool. But most of them have eyes, most of them have faces. And most of these animals that are mentioned here are vertebrates. They have bones, they have vertebrates. They're vertebrates just like us. And so that's actually kind of strange. Let me go to my PowerPoint. Because if you think about it, the vertebrate species are only 2% of the whole animal kingdom. So there are about 60,000 vertebrate species that are described. And yet the vast majority of the animal species are invertebrates. They're species without bones. They're the soft species. They're the echinoderms, corals, crustaceans, holothurians, all the insects, the mollusks, the sponges, the jellyfish. It's there. So it's kind of interesting that even though vertebrates only make up 2% of the whole animal kingdom, most animals that people mention are vertebrates. And that's not strange because we have this vertebrate bias. And I'm right now, I'm just checking if you guys can see this. Okay. Yeah. So what you have is this vertebrate bias. So we, as vertebrates, we have a stronger affiliation to other vertebrates. And so we do more research on them. We do more conservation on them, but it does mean that we're very blind to this huge portion of biodiversity. And just to bring into context really how strong that is, right? When I ask you how many species live in the sea, again, just in the chat, just put in some numbers. How many species, excluding microbes, live in the sea, more or less. What do we have here? How many species live in the sea? So we have about 2,000, about 400,000. Yeah, a lot. Yeah, a lot would be a good answer. Yeah. Okay, so I'm gonna take this away. And then basically, to some extent, the 400,000 is correct in the sense that it's estimated that about 1 to 2 million species live in the sea, yet only about 400,000 have been described. So it means that almost 2/3 of the biodiversity in the sea is still undescribed. And that's particularly in the area where you are in Indonesia and in the Coral Triangle, where you have the highest biodiversity in the world and marine biodiversity in the world in the Coral Triangle. It's particularly in that area where there are still many, many undescribed species. So this is unknown biodiversity that we also so it's unknown, so we're blind to it, but we're also just blind to generally invertebrates, as I showed. Again, just to bring it back, a lot of people like to work on marine mammals, so on dolphins and whales and yeah, others. How many marine mammal species are there actually? So there are only about 150. So if you think about that, right? So there's these millions of species in the sea, but there are only about 150 mammals. Now they're important and we should definitely take care of them. But if you think about how much research and funding and conservation is on them, maybe we should sort of reevaluate that a little bit. Same goes for sharks. Does anyone know how many sharks species there are? There are about 500. So again, super important to conserve, but it is important also to sort of see it in context of the whole biodiversity. So this is just my point to make that basically it's a spineless world out there. So a large portion, particularly if you're talking marine, a large portion of marine biodiversity is spineless, they're invertebrates. And you gotta be aware of that. Because right now a lot of research is quite biased towards vertebrates, and it's important to consider invertebrates because they have different life history strategies, they have different solutions to life, and as a result they also are they respond differently to disturbances than other organisms do, and it's something we should just consider when doing our research. Now getting back to marine biodiversity, one of the things that we're studying in my group is very much marine biodiversity, but also within the context of a changing world. So changing, yeah, due to long-term evolutionary processes, but also due to short-term ecological processes, and particularly due to things that we as humans do to the sea and how marine biodiversity changes. Now, one of the projects that that we're working on, and we're doing this together with IPB, is called Marine Time Machine, where we're interested in trying to understand the trajectories of change for tropical marine biodiversity in the Anthropocene. And this has been funded by the Dutch Research Council, MBO. And it's coming from the perspective of coral reefs, and coral reefs, as I'm certain you've had in many of your lectures and you've probably already seen and everything, they really support millions of people worldwide, and they provide coastal protection, they have food, livelihoods, and medicine. So they have a very important function and service for people. And if you go to coral reefs, you can see amazing coral reefs like this, so with high coral cover. This was taken, this picture was taken, I believe, in Manado. East Kalimantan. And then you can see that, but also near there, you can also see images like this. So this is a degraded reef where you see very little hard live coral cover. There's a lot of cyanobacteria, this red mat, these slimy red benthic cyanobacterial mats, sponges and algae. So you also see systems that have transitioned to these other species compositions. Now the benthic cyanobacterial mats are consortia. They're groups of bacteria that consist mostly of cyanobacteria, but there are also other microbes that are in there. And they can cause anoxia and produce toxins, and they kind of prevent corals and other organisms from settling. So if they become very, very big, it's really problematic for the reefs. And they come up when they're in areas where there's a lot of pollution from land coming in and where the corals have died. Because we know that the reefs are changing, and we know the main causes of coral reef decline are due to climate change, and predominantly due to increased water temperatures, that high water temperatures that cause corals to die off. But also local problems really stress the reefs. And there you can really think of overfishing, as well as all kinds of pollution, and in particular, low water quality, and low water quality from all kinds of things we do on land. So runoff from agriculture, from sewage, from sedimentation, from deforestation. But it's very important to consider this low water quality. Now, the key question really is sort of, with all these changes, what will the reefs look like in the future? What will they look like, and how will they function? And we have a little bit of an idea of what they may look like in the future from some long-term studies that have been done. And so this is from work from the Caribbean. And the reason I'm showing you the Caribbean, even though I know you're right now focused in Indonesia, is because the Caribbean has been going under a lot more stress than the Indo-Pacific, and maybe showing where the Indo-Pacific could be going. So, and it's also interesting because the longest data sets for sort of these long-term data sets exist from the Caribbean. So this is work that was done from different patches of reefs in the Caribbean, where the researchers went back every year or every 2 years and made photographs of the same patch of reefs over 40 years. It was started by Rolf Buck and then later taken over by Erik Meesters. And so what you see here on the x-axis are the years, so it's the time through time, and on the y-axis is the percent cover of the different groups. So what you see is that the coral cover was very high and through time declined, so went to a low cover situation, while the ecosystems transitioned to this more algae dominant state. And so that was found around the late 90s, 2000s, and a lot of research was then focused very much on the algae and the fish. And so this algae fish coral dynamic, and this grazers and algae and fish. And so it was sort of thought, okay, the coral reefs are going to transition into algae. But then this research kind of showed that the situation is a bit more complex, because what we saw is that in the last sort of 10 years, it's a bit more dynamic, and other emergent players have come up, and particularly these benthic cyanobacterial mats that I showed you before, as well as sponges have started coming up in these more degraded systems. So we're seeing things transition, but we know that the future reefs will probably not have the super high coral cover that it did in the 70s, but we still don't have a very good understanding of like what are the underlying bottom-up processes and the underlying dynamics that can cause these reefs to shift into, which groups will become more dominant. And that's really what we're trying to understand with our work. And one is with this marine time machine project, where we're using marine lakes as marine time machines. So these are small bodies of seawater that are entirely surrounded by land. So that's what you see here. And what's nice with them is they have marine water and they have marine organisms. And so you have these discrete marine communities replicated over space, but they differ in their temperature gradient. While they all have sort of similar low water quality levels, they all have quite a lot of influence from land. Then our time machine consists of sort of three components. So one are these marine lakes. Two are our reef sites, where we take advantage of sort of the natural gradient in water quality. So we take looking at reef sites that are, yeah, almost pristine, very healthy with very high coral cover, and then on to different sites that are really close to human activity, while their temperatures are kind of similar. And then we look into the past through sediment cores, because stratigraphics to sequences, so information from these sediment cores over time, can give us an information about how biodiversity changed over time and under what circumstances. And so through the year, so we're not going to look at one lake, but we're going to look at many different lakes, because through the years, my team, together with many people from IPB, UNIPA, as well as YEKAN and Conservasi Indonesia, we've been working in Raja Ampat and trying to look for all these lakes, and we've identified them, documented them, and trying to figure out what their setting is. From all that work, we selected 20 lakes, and these are 20 lakes in Indonesia, in Raja Ampat, predominantly in Misol and the Gam area, as well as Wayak. And what we have is that we have these lakes, they, if you go from one lake to the other, they kind of represent different temperature states. And as you go from one lake to the other with increase in temperature, we see quite a decrease in, oh, we see quite a shift in dominant groups. So we see this shift from coral algae dominated to more algae cyano dominated to really systems where algae disappears and where we're predominantly cyanos and sponges and actually also mollusks. And so what we have here are kind of natural states of what are predicted scenarios for the future in the worst case scenario, climate change scenario. So going up to 33 degrees. And what's nice is what we're particularly interested in is this combination of increased water temperature together with the stressor of land-based nutrients and low water quality. And that's exactly the setting that we have in the lake. So they give us an opportunity to sort of understand what kind of bottom-up processes may be at play that can cause these transitions. And so, well, there's one work package where we're working on that, where we're looking really at the community response to these environmental change. So there we're really quantifying natural patterns. And probably during your course, you've done a lot of these different techniques. So one area really with the photo transects, you're taking transects, making pictures, photographing them, quantifying them. The other is going with the sediment cores. And we're also doing genomics, where we're doing ancient DNA, where we're taking parts of the sediment cores to do ancient DNA to identify the biodiversity in the past, as well as doing eDNA based on very low DNA concentrations to try to understand what diversity is there. And we're doing that with different types of sequencing techniques, but one technique that we're trying to optimize is with what you see here with the MinION, as well as what's called the GridION. And these are mobile sequencers. And so they allow us to do this work if we're optimizing this right now, but once we're there, it allows us to really do that also, you know, in more remote locations or in smaller universities. So that's very much our aim, to optimize that, to make it more possible to do this kind of sequencing really locally. Then in our second focus, we're really asking sort of, okay, if these reefs change, so when you have this different system where these different groups are more dominant and less, what does that do to the functioning? What changes in the whole ecosystem? So we're interested then really more in the mechanistic understanding and also understanding how these different groups interact. So how they interact with respect to energy exchange. So we do food web analysis, as well as various experiments to see who takes up what food from who, and how does that change in these different environments, as well as really these spatial interactions. So really based on pictures and 3D models, trying to identify how these species interact. subsequently, what we're aiming to get to is to try to model then these, with all this empirical information, we then want to try to set up a model to model the trajectories of change in the Anthropocene. And for that, so what we're going to first work with a very simple model, a heuristic model where we sort of have through four components. We say, okay, we have corals, sponges, algae, and cyanos. And then we take the empirical data that we have from literature, as well as from our study of like, what are the growth rates? Also, what is the competition between these different groups? So some of these interactions we know, but many interactions we don't. And so that's really what we want to try to figure out. What is the competition and facilitation between these different groups? And then once we have that, we can sort of identify feedbacks, identify areas where there may be sort of a process going on that is really facilitating the growth of certain groups and really at the detriment of coral potentially. And then what we want to do is add in all the different drivers of change. So add in all the aspects that can cause change. So climate change, low water quality, overfishing, and play around with that to sort of model what kind of trajectories, what kind of composition can come out. And the cool thing is that because we have the sediment cores, we can do this modeling and then we can test whether our model makes sense based on what actually happened in the sediment cores. So we're working on that, on this project right now. We have some preliminary data, but I won't show that for now, but next year. And also, so that's together with quite a few PhDs in the Netherlands, also people working on the LPDP within our team and working together with DEA and Begin and Niken, hopefully soon too, on this project. So, when we talk about resilience, and I'm certain you've talked a lot about this in your program, the way we're looking at that is very much from the perspective that the resilience of a system is the ability of it to, yeah, take shocks, and it will change, but it can slowly recover and it can come back to the same system where it might not be exactly the same species, but the same functions are there. And what a lot of theoretical research has shown, and now more and more empirical research has shown, is that the resilience of a system can be, yeah, strengthened by reducing local stressors. So if you can reduce the local stressors that you can manage locally, so if you reduce the things that are daily constantly stressing out the reef, you do actually make them a lot stronger. You make them a lot more resilient to shocks like heat waves or marine heat waves or other types of, you know, temporary large shocks. And so it's from that perspective that we're doing a lot of our work as well, because it's very important to tackle climate change. But of course, a small village or a small island somewhere, I mean, they can do their best, but basically they don't have a lot of power with respect to change in climate change. But they do have a lot of power to change the local, what they're doing locally, to make certain that they don't cause a lot of pollution, that they keep the water quality high, that they basically don't stress out the reefs. So we know that these reefs are under stress from global processes, from climate change, but also from these local problems that stress the reefs, so overfishing, low water quality. But another local change that is causing a lot of change and effect is tourism. And so because I've been working in Raja Ampat, but also in Kalimantan Timur and Sulawesi, I've worked in various places where I've seen tourism grow rapidly, exponentially. And as a result, I've gotten much more interested in sort of the role that tourism plays within marine protected areas, and both the positive sides and the negative sides. And because tourism comes in many different shapes and forms. I mean, you have mass tourism, you have the local small losmans, you have the low homestays. It comes in many different forms. And so it also comes in many different forms of stressors as well as positive. And one of the thing with my team, what we're quite fascinated by is this double-edged sword that tourism presents. So it can really improve livelihoods. I mean, it can provide all kinds of economic input. It can, and it gives a lot of money. It can also finance marine parks. So it has many positive aspects. At the same time, if it's left completely unregulated, it really can cause a lot of harm, both socially, just both to social cohesion, with a high migration, it can change the social dynamic of a location tremendously. And also can, if you don't think about pollution and your sewage and what to do with garbage and what to do with fresh water, then a super increase of tourism can be a real big problem, both socially and to life underwater. And what's quite striking to me is that many marine protected areas are, you know, they're beautiful locations like this. This is from Selapanapana in Miso, and it's beautiful there. And many marine protected areas are beautiful, and therefore they are also highly, highly promoted for tourism. They're promoted on a national level, they're promoted on international level. I mean, Raja Ampat is, there are advertisements for Raja Ampat in the train station of Amsterdam. So it's highly, highly promoted for tourism. And yet there's not really any MPA management plan that has clear regulations for tourism, where tourism is maybe also seen as a stressor. And this is particularly work that Agustin Capriati has been working on. She's been digging through all the marine protected area, the MPA management plans. But the key thing is there's very little regulation for tourism, and yet they are highly promoted, they're invited in. And so that's why what we aim to do is really to focus on within this program to really think about what is tourism doing in marine protected areas. And ultimately with this aim to really build the resilience of marine protected areas in this age of climate change and tourism. And this project is called INREEF, and it's financed by Wageningen, by the INREF Fund, but it also, we have a lot of co-financing in the form of just really strong partnerships with IPB, as well as BRIN, as well as a various number of NGOs, and where there are a number of people doing doing their PhD with LPDP, but also where we're funding a number of sandwich PhDs. And we started a year or actually more ago, but it took a little time to build everything up. And now slowly all the PhDs are coming in. And so our main thing, what we're aiming to do is really to identify and develop tools to analyze how resilience can be measured, monitored, and governed. And really with this aim to safeguard the marine protected areas in a future of fluctuating tourism and climate change. And the locations that we've chosen are in Indonesia and the Dutch Caribbean, and we've chosen them very much with our partners, and we've chosen them sort of on the basis of areas that have different levels of tourism development as well as different degrees of reef health. And from that we've selected quite a few locations. We're not doing all locations as extensively. We're going to have a few locations going really in depth, and the rest are more sort of to test out our ideas. Now we're looking at these marine protected areas very much as a dynamic socio-ecological system. So what we mean with that is that, of course, these marine protected areas consist of a dynamic ecosystem as well as a dynamic social system, and they are all intertwined. And that's why we really feel that when it's important to see the links between underwater and above water. And they're also set up by a governance framework. So we're looking at this social ecological systems and also very much in a dynamic way. But of course, this marine protected area, it's an area that's been sort of identified and cordoned off. But the marine protected area is, of course, connected to the outside world. It's connected, ecologically, through hydrodynamics, through migration of people. It's connected to because of all kinds of governance. It's so this marine protected area is of course connected with the outside world, and so that's why we really are interested in the dynamic of the whole. And what's kind of nice with our thing is that we're not just looking at the dynamic of one system, but really the whole socio-ecological system. And the key question is really sort of how does it function and how is it influenced by these different stressors and particularly by tourism. And so we're looking at underwater. These are wonderful pictures by Avaluddin or Amat or Baban, as we'd like to call him. So we're looking at the diversity in the ecosystems underwater, really looking at the land-sea interface. I mean, I think you had lectures by Erik Horstman, and that's really his work. It's sort of like looking at this land-sea interface, also looking at the dynamics above water, and really on land and everything that comes with it. So as a result, we are quite a transdisciplinary team doing this, where we have a number of really disciplinary lines where we're interested in the biophysical flows, really looking at the biodiversity and the hydrodynamics, and there are a number of PhDs that are working in that line. Then we're really looking at the pollution flows, as well as the socioeconomics and governance. But we want to make certain that we don't just stay in our little lines and that we really look at this sort of, that we really work transdisciplinary through topic lines. So looking at the MPA through the lens of these different disciplinary lines, trying to develop indicators that work in the socio-ecological system, and also that ultimately can also help management plans, adaptive management plans, give them tools for adaptive management plans, as well as education. And so quite a number of these PhDs have now been filled. We're still very much interested in, we're looking for someone who's interested in working on the socio-ecological system. So very much on the really combining all the information together to think of a socio-ecological model. So if there's anyone that's interested in doing that in Indonesia, please contact either Dea or me, or Begin. And so what we want to do as an output is many different things. But one of the things is we want to bring all this information together in a dashboard. And our aim is really to make it an interactive dashboard that really is dynamic. So where we want to go away from is thinking a very static carrying capacity concept, because what happens is that people then just think, okay, well, a reef can have X number of tourists. But of course, the number of tourists will depend per location on so many things. For example, if you have an area where you have a good sewage system, where the sewage is not going directly in the sea, maybe that system can take a few more tourists. While if you are in a location that doesn't have a good sewage system, doesn't have a lot of fresh water, doesn't have a lot of garbage disposal, then you should not have too many tourists because the whole system can't take it. So we're trying to move away from static carrying capacity ideas and really more in these dynamic systems, so that with this dashboard, it's kind of a management, it's sort of a policy management helping tool, as well as an educational tool. And also just it gives the information that's there and it gives you an idea of where it's at. But like I said, if you have something like this, if for example, your indicators are red in the MPA, you of course want to know what to do. And we're working on this governance toolbox together with that. And also working towards monitoring, guidebook, and training, which of course already exists for many people, exists because there are lots of amazing organizations in Indonesia that are doing this. So it's just a question of bringing some things together, and maybe there's not even that much that needs to be done there, and it's just bringing it together. And then we have a few concrete, really tangible solutions that we're looking for. So we find that there's a lot of focus for fisheries, and that's good. And so there's already a lot of work on there. So we were looking for areas of where are really gaps in knowledge, where is really that we think that it's a big problem, but it's not being addressed maybe enough. And that's sanitation. So that's sewage. So we're working together with environmental technologists. We were really looking at different sanitation solutions for different settings. And so that's part. And an important part of the INRIF, which we haven't quite started as much yet, but that is something that will, as the PhDs are moving, they're also going to be creating educational content. So we're going to have an education hub where we'll have various knowledge clips, little videos in English and Bahasa on different topics, as well as methods. We'll also have some fellowships for students to join and work with on a citizen science app. So we want to work with an existing app, but just to add in plugins to get a bit more of this resilience idea in there. So we're doing this with a lot of different academic and private and public partners, as well as various NGOs. And it's been quite a travel getting this all together. We've been together in various forums in the field, and trying to develop, the questions and approaches that make most sense to the local team and everyone all over, so that we're looking at academic questions, but also questions that are relevant on the ground. What started all in Corona, setting it up. So we spent a lot of time online, but it was quite fun. And with that, I just would like to say thank you. And if there are any questions, please let me know.
All right. Thank you so much, Lisa. Maybe for all the participants, if you wanted to ask some questions, you can use the raise hand features before stating your questions to Lisa.
No questions. That's okay.
Lisa, maybe I have a question. I see that you already done your research in several places in Indonesia regarding about resilience. I wanted to ask is there any places that has the biggest potentials for the resilience, and what is the factor?
Well, I think the place that's shown maybe the most resilience so far has been Raja Ampat, because if you look at, if you talk about, let's say, heat waves and bleaching, right? So until recently, Raja Ampat hadn't had any bleaching. I think recently now there has been some. But then you can sort of think why. So in part, Raja Ampat is just lucky in the sense that its geomorphology, it's the way its bathymetry is set and the way it's set up, it's very shallow and then deep and then shallow and deep. So there's also cooler waters coming in. So in contrast to, let's say, the Great Barrier Reef it's a barrier reef. So it's also a shelf and reef. And so it has quite a lot of influence from land and a lot more hot water that stays there. So I think part of it is that. The other part is, it kind of comes to that point, what I was saying, it has a lot less stressors. I mean, not many people, even though tourism is growing and Waisai has exploded, even then, Raja Ampat still relatively has a lot fewer people than many other reefs. And so it means that there's just a lot less, there's lots of areas where there aren't constantly people going in. And so it also doesn't have very high development. So my worry is if you change that, If you do that, then potentially it won't be as resilient and you will probably have bleaching as well. But I don't know for certain. And the question is, how do you balance that? Because humans are part of the system. So you have to accept that. So you have to think about how do you weigh that out? And I think it can work, but you just have to think of it beforehand. Because what happens now is, particularly with tourism, it kind of just gets ignored. And then it isn't really considered until it already has done a lot of damage, and sometimes it's too late. So the thing that we're trying to bring forward is to think about these things before. Think about all the things that tourism can bring. So yes, it brings money. Yes, it brings financing for parks, but it also brings a lot of pollution. So it brings sewage pollution, waste, plastic pollution. It changes the social dynamics. So think about that before. I think that's the main thing.
Yeah. All right, thank you so much for your answers. Maybe is there anyone that wanted to ask questions? All right, so here we have Tida that already raised a hand. Tida, hello. Can you hear me?
Yeah. All right. Hello, Lisa. Hi. I just want to ask you, when you are in your research in Indonesia, are there any so many places that are affected by the instrument so many affected area or not?
Are the there? Sorry, one more time.
During your research, there are so many places that are affected by the instrument or ecological system or climate change. How many places did you find that? And here.
So how many places have been affected by humans? So I think everywhere. I don't think there are any ecosystems that aren't affected by humans, actually. Even the deep sea, you see traces of humans. So yeah. It's okay. I mean, the thing is, we affect the earth, right? We're part of the biosphere and we affect it. And so we should just sort of see that as we have a very, very strong influence on the planet. And so we've had some negative, a lot of negative, but it also means that it's in our hands to also make some positive changes. So I think it's important to think of it that way. But I don't think there's an ecosystem that isn't, I mean, there are very few ecosystems in the world that aren't affected by humans.
Are there any recovery by the ecosystem, by the quarry, by itself? Any recovery by
recovery? Itself? Absolutely. Oh yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's the thing that I find pretty amazing, right? Is because you see, if you give them the space, right? So if you, there are quite a few. MPAs where, you know, they've been there then for 10 years or longer, and if they truly have been given, you know, the space, so not with all the stress of overfishing, pollution, you do see a strong recovery. You see recovery of fish, you see a recovery of corals. Is it exactly the same as it was before? No, but you do see recovery. So I also think we have to have our aims at, like, where do you want to go? I think we have to be a bit realistic there. Yeah. I mean, in Raja Ampat, you saw an incredible recovery of fish and sharks and these things. But you also can see that, and particularly in Indonesia, I think the thing in Indonesia, which is something to be very, very happy about and to be very hopeful about, is this point that there are still a lot of very good, very healthy, high biodiversity reefs. And so the sea is full of larvae of all these different animals. And so if you really focus to make a few areas better and really just take away the stress and give them the circumstances that they can grow well, it can recover. I do see that, definitely. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, we also have Bifari here.
Okay, can you hear me? Is this clear?
Yes.
Okay, good. So I just joined this webinar and I figured out it's something along the line of, it's something along the line of tourism and its effect and how conservation can handle that. Is that what it's about?
In part, yes.
Okay, so I wanted to ask if how much of conversation is really recovery, right? Because we end up introducing a species out of we wanted to focus on the recovery of, let's say, coral without any specific notation of what species this is or whether they're native to this area or not, it might end up being invasive. So in terms of conversation, in terms of reintroducing animals back to the place that they seemingly belong, is there any way we can lower the risk of overthrowing the biodiversity from the introduction of non-native species, besides identification? Just, you know, that they might accidentally hitch a ride. I've heard tales of like aquarium owners accidentally bringing in sea creature that isn't from the catalog into their aquarium, for example.
Yeah, no, thanks for that question. So I think in the sea, I'll be quite clear. I don't think you should introduce species. I think the risks don't totally are too high because they're unknown, too high. I don't think you should introduce species at all. When species have been introduced unintentionally, it's not worked out very well. So and this also comes to the point that I'm trying to bring in any case in Indonesia. I mean, I know Indonesia better than many other systems, so I think it's the case in many other systems too, but in any case in Indonesia, because the biodiversity is still so high in Indonesia and you do still have many, many good places, there's no reason to introduce new species. Make the setting healthy and good and stress-free, and the species will come. So I think introducing species in the sea is a risk that's not worth taking. Yeah. You know, as humans, we haven't had a very good track record of introducing species into ecosystems. You know, think about all the problems in Australia, right, with the frog and the bunnies. And then think about also Lake Tanganyika, where they introduced the Nile perch, which ate all the other fish. We're not very good at introducing species. So I think what we should do is just stop stressing the coral, stop stressing the ecosystems. That put all the effort in that. Yeah. Thanks, though.
Got it. So, okay. Mind if I get one more question in?
It's fine with me, Nikan. Is that okay?
Oh. Yes, you may ask your questions.
So, since I just joined in, I'm not so sure if there is any information or previous questions regarding the topic that we'll discuss right now, but what do you think about, let's say, I wouldn't say genetically modifying, but just modifying corals so that they will be resistant? I've read a lot of articles and watched some videos about articles and research papers on corals being modified to be more, let's say, resistant to higher temperatures and acidity by, for example, running them through high pressure water so it builds the polyps and it builds the calcium carbonate carapace to be much tougher. Is this ideal, or in the long run, in terms of making corals less stressed out and therefore making the ecosystem stress free, is this an ideal solution?
So I think there's quite a lot of work on, for example, also assisted evolution in making corals, more resilient, particularly more. I only know mostly to heat stress, but I found it interesting what you were saying of making them like stronger. That's an interesting one too. So that research gives so much information about. Generally, also by doing that research, we get a lot more ideas about how corals deal with life. So I think it's very, very valuable research. I think, you know, there is not going to be one solution, I think, because the problem is quite big. So we do need to focus on a number of different solutions. Now, I do think that making certain that we spend a lot of money and effort on trying to reduce the pollution and the stress, so reducing, getting sewage treatments, wastewater treatments, stopping coastal development and deforestation. I think a lot of energy and money should be put on that. But I do also think that this other track, let's say, of making them more resilient is definitely something worth checking. I think what's key is that, it's just not, it's important not to see it as the only solution, because if all our effort only goes in that, there are two problems. One, they typically only look at a few species. Now there are hundreds of coral species, and if we only look at a few species, yeah, then we're not getting a coral reef back, right? And because a reef is a big structure with a hard structure with lots of different species. And the other issue is that there, you can make it super tolerant for maybe one stressor, but what if another stressor comes up? Then, yeah, then it's gone. So I think the research is super important and is very valuable. And I think it's one line of solution. I don't think it's the only line. That's my main thing. Yeah.
That makes sense. I got it.
Okay, is there any other questions from the participants? Okay, maybe if there's no other questions, we can end the first sessions here. Thank you so much, Lisa.
Thank
really
you.
Really looking forward to meeting you very
yes.
soon.
Yes. Yes.
And so after this, we will play videos of our field trip programs that already held earlier this month. So is the video already? Okay. Okay, so here's the after movie of our field trip programs in this summer course 2023. Please enjoy the video.
That girl set me up with her. Dance with me, baby, let's get lost right here.
Okay, so there's the after movie of our field trip activity, which we do some kind of activity such as a drone flight training and also sea turtle release. And we also do some kind of coral transplantations. So in Pramuka Island, most of the coral are coming from the transplantation. So they are already got most of them is bleached. So most of the coral that we find during the field trips are from the transplantation activity. Okay, so without missing much time, I wanted to ask you to give a reactions for our after movie for the field trips. And also our first lecture, Dr. Lisa, maybe you can give the reactions. All right, thank you so much for the reactions. Once again, I also wanted to thank Dr. Lisa for the outstanding presentations for today's general lectures. So let's go straight to the second sessions that will be delivered by Dr. Alan Karapitan. Dr. Alan, can you hear me?
Yeah.
All right, so the time and place is yours.
All right, thank you, Niken, and good afternoon, everyone. Also, thank you for the nice talk from Lisa. We have not been in touch for a while. And finally, we met virtually. I remember when we met when we visit Amsterdam, in Amsterdam, I don't know, 5 years ago. And then Lisa invited us to join a dinner in her house. I thank you very much. Actually, first time for me when I enjoy hummus.
Yeah, together with Almi, right?
Right. Together with Almi. And I was thinking what kind of food this one. Hummus, I think it's kind of like a marine sponge. And I check in the Google, oh, this is like a peanuts, olive oil, and some ingredients. Thank you very much. All right, so my talk will be more focused on the driver. So not so much pay attention for the resilient, but I try to share about the alternative action for adaptation. And yeah, alternative action means progressive, but still in progress. And I will talk about the history, about how the world react with the climate change issues, and then the climate change as a driver, natural driver, and also I will move to the anthropogenic driver. And then after that, I will show about the several research results regarding the climate change impact on the Indonesian seas. And okay, just a moment, I need to, I don't know how to set the bar line, the black bar line in my screen, but all right. So this is the current status of atmospheric CO2 concentration. And then so far it's been rising up 51% since the Industrial Revolution, 1750-something. It was 277 ppm. And then right now, it's already 417 ppm in the atmosphere. So this is quite a significant increase. the atmospheric CO2 concentration. And this is the quite a little bit information about the climate change action. I mean the world react with the climate change issues. So it was coming from the book wrote by Rachel Carson. The title is Silent Spring. Actually, Rachel is a marine biologist, as far as I remember. She's a marine biologist, but she wrote about the, this is a fiction book, and she wrote about the impact of climate change and environmental change, particularly the environmental change in general, affects the butterfly, the bird migration, something like that. And then the book was giving inspiration for the many people, and then started to think about the impact of the development on the environmental damage. So it was 1962, and then 10 years later, the United Nations held the conference on human environment in Stockholm. And then after that, they established the United Nations Environment Program. And then later on, the World Commission on Environment and Development. And then 30 years later, we have, you know, the Earth Summit in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. And then after that, the UN developed the UNFCCC. And then the for the decision making panel, they developed the, you know, the Conference of the Parties. And in addition with the Conference of the Parties, UN assigned the World Meteorological Organization and UNEP to develop Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the IPCC. And then including the prominent scientists among the world, the IPCC was or has been measuring the climate change scientifically and then published the report until now. And then this is the natural climate change according to Wally. We call him Wally, the late Wally. I met him in the time maybe 2009 something, when I was in Minnesota, and then he was in the time 83, 85 years old, but now he's already passed away. And he mentioned many things about the natural climate change. And then he made a testimony in the US Senate, because some people blame about the hoax of the climate change. And then he mentioned that, okay, our climate system do has natural climate variability. But I will explain later. Right now we are under anthropogenic impact, and then affects our climate variability. And then now we know the climate change. So this is okay. So this is according to the ice coring, yeah? And then we can trace back 400,000 years. And then this is the glacial interglacial variability. And then we can see here the CO2 in that time was something 200 ppm until 300 something, right? ppm. And then the temperature, the Earth's temperature variable between minus 10, this is a global average, minus 10 until 10 degrees Celsius. And then we know this is the variability related with the glacial, interglacial in the global climate or the global climate system. And then among the 100 or among the glacial, interglacial climate variation, there is another cycle that we call precession cycle. So this is related with the Earth's rotate the sun, and then the position of the rotation, the position of the road of the Earth is not like circle, full circle, but it is like an ellipse. So that's why sometimes the Earth, when it moves, rotate the sun, sometimes we are in the Earth, but we are quite close to the sun, but sometimes we are far away from the sun during the rotation cycle. So this is related with the spin axis position, and then changes every 11 years. And then for the total cycle, we call it the precession cycle. The total period, I mean, is 20 or 26,000 years for the one period. So that's why when I go back to the glacial interglacial climate variation, we can find here another cycle within 100,000 years cycle. So that was, or that is 26,000 cycle. Okay. And then for the consequences of the glacial interglacial climate variation, it was an event that we call the last glacial maximum. That means this is the last interglacial, sorry, the last glacial event in the world. And then it was occurring during something thousand years ago. And then after that, the sea level was rising. Yes, 21,000 years before present. And then the sea level was rising, actually been rising until now. And we can see here, after LGM, after the last glacial maximum, the sea level was rise up to 100-something meter, 100 meter something. Yeah. And then I got the information from Zhao et al., the condition of topographic in the Southeast Asia. And yeah, we can see here the Sunda Shelf was in the time was a terrestrial, was a land connected with the Asian continental. And then right now, has been changed to become a Muang Thai or Thailand waters, and also part of the Java Sea waters. Next. And then another implication after LGM. So I'm talking about the natural variability. So after LGM, another implication, this is quite connected with the role of thermohaline circulation. So probably some students which has a physical oceanography background, probably you familiar with the thermohaline circulation. And this circulation, in fact, was controlling the bring the hot, not hot, but the heat transport from the tropical region to the temperate region. So for example, in the tropical area of the north of the Atlantic Ocean, the thermohaline circulation will bring water mass with properties of heat slightly or hotter compared to another properties, seawater properties, and then brings the water mass to the North Atlantic. And then after that, in the north, there is a deep water formation, and the high salinity and hotter water mass will sink down and then become the blue line. And then the blue line is related with the circulation in the deep part of the ocean. So that means when the temperature after LGM was increasing, that means the sea ice, the ice in the Arctic region in the north will be melting. And then after ice melting, they produce the fresh water and affects the deep water formation. So it is hard for the deep water formation to sink down because of the ice melting. Okay. And then when we can see here, after the ice melting during LGM, and then we see here in the 15,000 years ago, as a response, quick response after LGM, the temperature is increasing abruptly, suddenly. And then, you know, the snow accumulation in the 15,000 years ago, the snow accumulation was also rising up. Increase, increase, increase. And then after that, again, abruptly climate change, the temperature was dropped down. So this is quite related with the thermohaline circulation in the North Atlantic. Okay, so after ice melting, after temperature is increasing, the ice should be melting. But why the snow accumulation was increased 15,000 years ago? in other side, the temperature is increasing. Yeah, in the 15,000 years ago, we can see here, because the heat means energy. So the hotter water mass from the tropical area was shut down because the circulation is not smooth anymore. So imagine when you are in the airport and then you wait for your luggage, I mean, and then the trajectory, the belt in the belt luggage, and then you have to wait for several minutes or probably 1 hour or something, depend on the dense of the people. But when somebody disrupt the belt, that means you need to wait longer, right? So this is quite similar. So that's why sometimes thermoline circulation, we call it the great conveyor belt. Yeah, quite similar with the belt. When somebody disrupt, when the ice melting disrupt the circulation, that means the heat supply from the tropical area to the North Atlantic was becoming decreased. So that's why when the temperature increase, ice melting is increasing to the snow accumulation is becoming wider in that time. So that's the explanation why the temperature is increasing. In the same time, the snow accumulation also increase. So after that we worry about that, because right now is the indication is quite similar. After the temperature and the snow accumulation had been increasing, and then suddenly the temperature dropped down, and then after that increased again. So it was called younger, drier period in the time, and because of the thermohaline circulation was shut down in North Atlantic. Younger driest periods means the vegetation in the highland was found in the lowland, in the near coast, something like that. And the vegetation of dryers, I think, I forget the name of the vegetation, but it was found not in the highland, but in the low land, and then they call it younger dryers period. And after that, I will explain later. There was medieval warm period and little ice age. Okay. So is the thermohaline circulation is shutting down again, or Europe is freezing? The indication about that can be expressed with the salinity changes in subpolar waters in the North Atlantic. So we have a salinity cross-section in 1968 until 72, and then another section was measured during 1993 until 97. And then when we compare the salinity profile during 98 until 72 compared to 1950 until 59, we found here the red color. That means the salinity profile in 1968 until 72 was higher than salinity profile or salinity concentration during 1950 until 59. However, when we compare the salinity concentration in 1993 until 97 compared to 50 until 59, it was minus. That means the ice melting is becoming significant during 1993 compared to 68. And it has been melting until now. Okay. So that's why we worry about these results, because we ever has experience during the younger dry period. All right. Another cycle related with the natural cycle is related with sunspot activities and the bond cycle, or we call it a 14 carbon isotope production in the atmosphere. So this is the sunspots observation since Galileo, and its correlation with solar radiation. So in the left panel, we can see here the sunspots observation since Galileo era, and then we can see here the number of sunspots, and then in the right panel, the number of sunspots has strong correlation with the solar radiation. Okay, so the solar radiation means affects the air temperature. But please keep in your mind, the influence of solar radiation is still not significant to rise up the air temperature as observed recently. Okay, so you already informed the natural cycle. We have the first one, the glacial interglacial 100,000 years cycle. The second one, precession cycle, okay, 26,000 years cycle. And then the thermohaline circulation cycle after the LGM. The thermohaline circulation is related with, let's say, 1,000 years cycle. And then the last one, we have 10, 11 years cycle. Okay. So this is a natural cycle related with the climate change. Then, what next? Okay. So in the beginning, I introduced the atmospheric CO2 has been reached until 418 something ppm. So this is sharply increased compared to the natural one. And then what's happened? So that's we call the anthropogenic impact or anthropogenic climate change or the human perturbation. Okay, according to the Global Carbon Project, they already compile the data, and then this is the anthropogenic perturbation of the global carbon cycle, and we see here the fossil fuel CO2 contribute significantly compared to another sources like land use or even another anthropogenic cycle. And this is the global fossil CO2 emission. It was rising up since 1990 until the last one, 2022. So it's already increased year by year. And then right now we have reached 30, 40 gigaton CO2. And then this is the total global emission, 40 something gigaton CO2, or almost 50% over the 1990 average emission condition. And then this is the fate of anthropogenic CO2 emission during the last decade. And the main sources was coming from industry. The industry contribute almost 90% of the anthropogenic CO2 in the atmosphere. And then 10%, 11% contributed by the land use change. And then for the sink, 48% of the anthropogenic CO2 was still remain in the atmosphere. 29% was absorbed by the land vegetation, the forest, thing like that. And 26% was absorbed by the ocean. When I mention the ocean, I'm talking about the global ocean, not the regional one, not the bay, not the, you know, the small waters, but this is the global ocean. And then this is an illustration from Chris Sabine. He talked about the anthropogenic and then the natural carbon cycle. The natural one refers to the black color, and then the anthropogenic one refers to the red color. So let's focus on the ocean. In the beginning, not beginning, but in the natural cycle, the ocean, the global ocean, acted as a source in the time. So ocean absorbed 70 petagram carbon per year, and then the ocean released 70.6 petagram carbon per year to the atmosphere. So that means we got plus 0.6. Oops, just a moment. So we got plus 0.6 petagram carbon per year to release to the ocean. So naturally, the ocean act as a sources for the anthropogenic CO2. Sorry, not the anthropogenic, for the atmospheric CO2. And then when we add the black color, the black font and the red font, the 70 plus 21.9, that means we got 91.9, right? Absorbed by the ocean. And then release back just only 90.6 petagram carbon per year. So we got minus 1.3. So that's why under anthropogenic perturbation, the ocean acts as a sink. Okay? So it was changes. It was changing the equilibrium. The first, the ocean acted as a source, and then right now has been changing, become a sink for the atmospheric CO2. So is the ocean becoming oversaturation? So we go to another slide, next slide. So this is the ocean sink according to the Global Carbon Project. They reported that the ocean sinks of the CO2 flux is increasing since 1960 until 2020 something, yeah, until now. However, when we see in the last 5 years the data show the oceanic flux or the oceanic sinks tend to become stagnant. Okay? So we worry about this. Because once the ocean stop absorb the atmospheric CO2 anymore, that means the ocean has becoming oversaturation for the CO2 concentration. And then we just wait for the next new equilibrium. Okay, we don't know. And then this is the, okay, this is the terrestrial sink, the land carbon sink. Yeah, this is quite dynamics. And this is for the, this is a warning for us. This is the remaining carbon budget if we want to keep the limit global warming up to 1.0 degrees Celsius or 1.7 degrees Celsius or 2 degrees Celsius. That means we have only 380 gigaton or 730 gigaton for the 1.7 degrees Celsius scenario, or for the 2 degrees Celsius scenario, we still have 1,230 gigaton CO2. And then this is equivalent to the 9, 18, and 30 years from this year. Okay? again, the remaining carbon budget, the global CO2 emission must reach zero to limit the global warming for the next decade. So we have a very tight schedule. We have very limited action in order to reduce the CO2 emission. All right. And then that's the driver. And then right now, many scientists was trying to find another sources. So we do have the terrestrial thing. Sorry, not another sources, but another thing, I mean. Terrestrial thing, oceanic thing, and then the new, not new, but the recent proposal that we call blue carbon. And then the blue carbon is related with the estuary smolt marshes, seagrasses, mangrove carbon sink. And now this issue is becoming popular. I don't know why, but yeah, it was estimated that the blue carbon sink will store between 200 until 450 teragram carbon. So this is 0.4, 0.5 petagram. So not so significant. And this is the some research project in the mangrove surrounding waters. And some estimation from Komiyama, and this is for the seagrass, I think, and then recent publication also from Alongi. He found that the mangroves has a potential absorption of CO2 much higher than compared to the terrestrial vegetation. And then in Indonesia, we have 3 million something hectare compared to another countries. Indonesia has the largest mangrove ecosystem in the world. But we need to keep that, because according to Daniel Murdiarso, he found that during 3 or 4 decades, the mangroves area has been declining year by year. It was higher than 4 million hectare, but recently it's already 3 something million. And then this is equivalent with the 0.1, 0.2 petagram CO2 emission. Okay. And yeah, this is some study case still in preparation. We try to measure the carbon sink in mangrove vegetation. Actually, this is the restoration area after rehabilitation, and then we measure the carbon sink in that area. And this is the study area, and 2003 was starting restoration. So it was a pond area, and then after that they tried to replanting again, and then in 2016 we went there, and then we measure the carbon sink in the mangrove restoration area. And yeah, this is the salinity profile, and yeah, some documentation related with the sediment coring. And this is for the we divided the sediment core, and then we use PB dating, in order to measure the sedimentation rate and also to estimate the sediment age below ground. And yeah, finally, we found the carbon sequestration in sediments during post-restoration. And then we found here that the mangrove sediments has higher carbon sequestration in the older restoration area compared to the younger restoration area. Okay, and yeah, we are lucky with the mangrove ecosystem, because beside the mitigation in order to mitigate the CO2, to absorb the atmospheric CO2, the mangrove ecosystem also function as a coastal protection, nursery, feeding, spawning grounds, not only for the carbon storage. So that's why mangrove can be another solution, not only for mitigation, but also for adaptation in the coastal region. Okay. And I try to briefly introduce the several studies on the impact of climate variability and changes in Indonesian waters. And then, yeah, we can use this knowledge as a basis for adaptation strategy, right? I'm lucky because I have extra time, right? But please remind me if I pass the time. So this is the impact of climate change adaptation strategy in the small scale fisheries. And they found that the strategies, including technology adoption, changing their fishing gear and shifting fishing time and location. So they have a questionnaire, and then after that, they interview the fishermen. And then this is rice from the fishermen. They need technology adoption. And this is the observation from Bahtiar. He reported that the tuna fishing ground has been shifting in the Eastern Indian Ocean. Started from the 1973 until 2000, the tuna fishing ground was not so far, just around the southern Java island. But right now, it's been shifting far away from the initial fishing ground. And then another report from the International Organization on Tuna Commission, they reported that in 2011 and 2012, again, the tuna migration was moving far away from the initial position near the southern coast of Java Island. Okay, and then still the impact of climate change. This is the report published by Pat Johnson, and he found that the sea level rise affects big eye tuna fishing layer. So when the fishing layer is becoming deeper, that means the fisherman needs to adjust the long line fishing gear. And this is the still with Pak Johnson. And the sea level rise, this is the illustration of when the sea level rise and then affects the big eye tuna fishing layer, and then it brings consequences, the fishing layer becoming deeper and deeper, and they don't have any capacity to adjust because they need more effort, they need more money in order to modify the fishing gear. And then this is related with the climate variability, particularly the negative and positive Indian Ocean dipole events. And the strong downwelling occurs when the negative Indian Ocean dipole occurs in the Eastern Indian Ocean. And reversely, when the positive Indian Ocean dipole occurs, that means the strong upwelling also happen in the Eastern Indian Ocean or in the southern coast of Java Island. And then Pa Johnson was correlate with the small pelagic fishes, small pelagic catchment. And then when the upwelling, the strong upwelling, and then the strong downwelling happens, and then the fish capture up and down, according to the upwelling and downwelling. And the downwelling and the upwelling is strong control by the Indian Ocean dipole event. And then, I found in the mackerel tuna, when the extreme negative IOD, we found here that there was fish capture anymore, or very, very small capture compared to the normal year. So that means the mackerel tuna production significantly dropped in 2016 when the negative IOD event, and rose in 2017 in the normal year. So that again, the Indian Ocean dipole or IOD strongly control the fish stock in the southern coast of Java or in the Eastern Indian Ocean. And then this is, I published this modeling results related with the stock of the small pelagic fish biomass in the Indonesian seas. And then I try to model during RCP 4.5 scenario in 2025 and RCP 4.5 scenario in 2050. And then during 2025, the fish stock will increase. Okay. However, in the long term, in the 2050, the fish stock will decrease. Okay. So this is some preliminary results regarding the model, the modeling study, in order to estimate the fish stock under a climate change scenario. And okay, this is a recent publication from Chai et al. In the Nature Review. And he found that more frequent strong El Nino and La Nina events since 1960 because of the climate change. So that means the implication of climate change will alter the climate variability. And then, for example, ENSO, IOD, they tend to be more frequent, strong, compared to 1960 and below before. So that we are facing more extreme climate in the next future if we have no strong action in order to limit the emission in the atmospheric CO2. Okay. And then another study, I almost finished. Yeah, I tried to calculate the climate change vulnerability index in the Java Sea. So we have exposure. Exposure means the driver. So exposure consisting of climate change parameters like SST trend, rainfall trend, wind speed trend. And then we use the data from 1999 until 2008. And then for the sensitivity, we adopted the chlorophyll A data, DIN data, DIP data from the model results in the Java Sea. And then we combine with the adaptive capacity and we define that the adaptive capacity in this case is related with the coral reef coverage, mangrove coverage, and seagrass coverage. And then we use the 2003 data condition from the Landsat TM image data. And then this is the nutrient loads in the Java Sea. I ever calculate this on model study for the Java Sea. And we use the biogeochemical model to calculate the DIP, the dissolved inorganic nitrogen and phosphor distribution in the Java Sea. And then after that, we combine with the exposure, we combine with the sensitivity and the adaptive capacity. And then we found here, this is the climate change index vulnerability in the Java Sea. And then we found here in the southern coast of Kalimantan, the index is very high compared to another location in the Java Sea. Okay, and then for the adaptation scenario, we note that the impact of the SST positive trend in the Java Sea has to balance with the role of the adaptive capacity parameter. That means we need to rehabilitate the coastal ecosystem like mangrove, seagrass, and coral reef. And then the impact of rainfall positive trend in the future needs to address by preparing the strict land use regulation, the spatial planning, mainly to minimize the organic and inorganic riverine inputs, particularly in the southern coast of Kalimantan and some part in the Jakarta Bay, Semarang in the central Java. And then the protection and rehabilitation of the coastal ecosystems are needed in enhancing the adaptive capacity action. Okay, and I think two slides more. And then this is the summary. Oh, unfortunately, this is in Bahasa. So for the summary, the climate change together with the another human perturbation like human housing, industry, agriculture, and opening peatland, and then combined with the climate change effect, it will affect double for the food security in Indonesia. So that's the summary of the implication of climate change and other human perturbation impact on the Indonesian seas. And then for the future work, we have a current collaborative research project among APB University and University of British Columbia in Vancouver, the PI Pa Johnson, and I'm the co-PI. And then right now we try to modify the vulnerability index, and then we use the recent formula adopted from Sebits et al. And then we use IPCC report, the recent IPCC report combined with the community-driven and ecosystem-based adaptation measure to the climate change. And then after that, we combine the potential impact, the adaptive capacity, and then the adaptation measure in order to estimate the vulnerability. All right, so I think that's all. Thank you very much. And I give back to the committee. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much, Dr. Alan.
Yeah.
If there's any participants that wanted to ask questions to Dr. Alan, you can use the raise hand features and then I will allow you to speak.
Any question?
All right, Dr. Alan, maybe if there's not yet any questions, I wanted to ask questions regarding your materials. So I see there's a lot of factors that driven the climate change. In the research that you've been doing, is there any particular factors that is the main factors for the climate change, and what is the sectors that are contribute into these things?
Yeah, actually, this is a complex system. So we do have natural cycle plus anthropogenic cycle to become the climate change cycle in general. In other activities, we do have also human perturbation like pollution, human like a land use change in the coastal area, many things, and we need to, you know, to combine all. So that's the complex system. And then that's why we use modeling, because this is so many aspects. And then we need a computer to model the interaction among the natural cycle, climate change, human perturbation, and so on. So it is hard for me to find which one is the main factor. So depend on the area, depend on the study area. For example, in the Java Sea, I found that temperature and rainfall were the main factor or main parameter of the climate. However, nutrient flux from the rivers, from the terrestrial, or nutrient supply from human activities in the land is also important. So that's why we use model, and then we use the vulnerability assessment in order to get the vulnerability index. It's something something like that. So again, depend on the area that we would like to study. Yeah, you can.
All right. Thank you so much for the answer. Maybe following the questions before, I wanted to ask if you are, if you have any suggestions on the preventive actions that we can do.
Hello, Niken. Are you still there? I think, could you repeat again? I think some noisy, and then I could not
okay.
Your question.
Hello?
Yeah, go ahead. I don't know, is this a problem with my internet connection, or anybody can respond my comment? Hello? Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, I do, Pak.
Oh, okay. How about Niken? Anybody hear
me? Hello, Dr. Lodi, can you hear me?
I think the problem is in your internet connection. Niken, could you repeat again? Yes, Niken. Hello. Niken. Anybody or any committee could handle this problem?
Hello, Dr. Lalan, can you hear me well?
Yeah, go ahead, Niken.
Okay, so sorry, I changed my device before.
Okay, go ahead. Please repeat again the question.
Okay. All right, so following the previous questions, I want to ask if you have any suggestions on any kind of preventive actions for this climate change, or do you agree with Dr. Lisa's statement on my previous question also in her sessions, that she said we have to manage the people first before for us to be able to manage the ecosystem.
Yeah, actually, it is hard to manage the people. But I would suggest to continue in rehabilitating the mangroves, because the mangrove ecosystem could be acted as a carbon sink, but also has a function for adaptation. Okay, the mangrove ecosystem could absorb the atmospheric CO2 three until four times compared to terrestrial vegetation. In the same time, the mangrove ecosystem keep or protect our coastline, and also the mangrove ecosystem can be a nursery area or nursery ground for the small fishes, and feeding area and also spawning area for the some small species or some small marine biota, so that we can keep the species, we can keep the biodiversity in the same time. So that's why our government right now focusing on the mangrove rehabilitation beside the peatland rehabilitation. So we have now the National Agency for Peatland and Mangrove Rehabilitation, or in Bahasa, Badan Rehabilitasi Gambut dan Mangrove Nasional. Yeah. Yeah, of course we need to manage the people, but yeah, it is hard. I'm not social people. I mean, my background in the physical, in the oceanography, but I think also good to build the system that legally keep or legally binding the people action. But I would suggest the mangrove rehabilitation beside keep the good ecosystem of mangrove. Yeah, Niken.
All right, thank you so much for the answer, Dr. Alan. Once again, maybe I wanted to ask the participants here, if you wanted to ask questions to Dr. Alan, please use the raise hand feature first.
Yeah, you can ask anything related with climate.
Okay, if there's no other questions, maybe Dr. Alan, if you don't mind to share your email. So maybe if the participants wanted to ask furthermore about this topic, they can immediately contact you through the email. If you don't mind, you can write your email address in the chat room.
All right. Just a moment. Okay.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Alan. Thank you for the materials that you have been delivered today. Because of our short time, maybe we can finish the second sessions in here.
Yes. Thank you very much. And more success for you.
Thank you also, Dr. Alan. Maybe if the participants, once again, if you wanted to ask more questions to Dr. Alan, you can contact him through the email in the chat room. Maybe I wanted to kindly ask if you can give reactions to Dr. Alan. All right. Once again, thank you so much, Dr. Alan. Hopefully we can meet soon, maybe in Bogor. And for all the participants, I wanted to remind you for this summer course, we also have the modules and exam that you have to finish until 30 October. Sorry, until October 31st of October. So don't forget to finish your module in the OCHEWE website. Okay, so once you finish the modules and exams, you can claim the credits and get the certificates for the summer course. All right, ladies and gentlemen, maybe those are the agendas that we have presented to you today. As we have finished our lectures, once again, we would like to thank you, our speakers, Dr. Lisa Baking and Dr. Alan, for sharing very insightful knowledge and valuable insight. Please give reactions to our speakers and the committee. I also wanted to thank all the participants and the students for these sessions. Hopefully the presentations will be beneficial for us. And from the deepest of our heart, we do apologize for our mistakes in presenting this event. Before we close this general lecture, maybe that's all. Once again, thank you for making time in your busy schedule to join us here. I wish you all a pleasant day. We hope to see you again soon. And here I end our agenda for today. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.